everybody's at. Particularly, how many people play guitar with an unwound third string? How many people just play an acoustic guitar or some guitar with a wound third string and never bend strings? Okay. You're going to have to work harder on a couple of these things. Most everything that I'll talk about today will be adaptable for any kind of guitar, including classical guitars. But one thing I want to talk about is double bends, and that requires an unwound third string or absurd amount of strength. We're short on handouts, and we might have them by the end of this class. Otherwise, we will have them by next week. And anybody who, for some reason, can't be here next week or will just be here today should talk to me, and we'll make some sort of arrangement because there'll be an outline of all the stuff we're going to talk about. I guess I'll be doing the first two classes. Then what happens?
Then Fred Clark is going to do one. Michael Hedges is going to do two, and I'm going to do one.
Okay. There you have it. Yeah, I'd like to start right out with I don't know, first of all, how many people have heard me play at some point? Or more significantly, how many people haven't heard me play? Okay, it's about half and half. Okay, I'm pretty much, for those of you who haven't heard me, I'm pretty much known as a solo guitar player, because that's what I've been doing for the last few years. And I play as half of a duo, Tuck and Patti, and my wife's a great singer. And since I've been doing that, I've developed a lot of unusual techniques, both for a solo guitarist and just for a regular guitarist. Most of what I've come up with you can use in a regular guitar situation where you're one of several instruments playing. Randy, is this coming out okay?
Play the guitar a little bit for me.
Okay. 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 So I think what I'd like to do is just play a little first. I guess I've built a style on the unorthodox, almost, and trying to make the unorthodox, for me, orthodox. So what for me is a normal technique might be an unusual technique for you. And I want to play a little bit just to give you a sense of some of the kinds of things I do, and then I'll start talking about them. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, that's an example of one of the things I do a whole lot, which is getting a lot of stuff happening at once, getting bass line happening and so forth, while comping is going on. And also while backbeat's going on. I don't know if anybody's noticing that, but there's a lot of this going on. But really the reason I did that was to point out some more subtle things that I do a lot, and to try to make the point that although this stuff can be thought of as unusual techniques and, to me, tricks on the guitar, a lot of things will be transparent to an audience, including an educated audience, meaning an audience made of guitar players, if you really work them into your style. I find myself doing a lot of funny fingerings, for example, playing one note and then switching fingers on that note while I'm holding it, which you'll never even notice as it goes by if you're watching, but sometimes it gets you out of a lot of sticky situations. Likewise, a lot of unorthodox fingerings, cross bars, thumb around the neck, thumb around the neck in more subtle ways. People usually don't even see that kind of stuff when it goes on. See? Anyway, I'll get into as much of that kind of stuff as I can. Then there's the flashier kind of stuff, the thumb kind of stuff. I do a lot of bass techniques on the guitar. And then there are various slapping kind of things and harmonic techniques that you saw towards the end of that one. I think I did a passage. And there are a whole lot of different things you can do with harmonics. And as much as possible, I'm going to get into all of those we can. Okay, I'm going to start with something that I only did once in that song, which was double bends, because it's one of the first unusual things I learned to do on the guitar. Do people already do this? Does everybody already know this? Everybody knows the peg solo? Everybody, no. Okay. Everybody knows the Midnight at the Oasis solo, the classic double bend solos. Okay, the trick to this is instead of bending one string, bend two strings. Okay. For those who have guitars, probably what we're going to do is do a few things and have you do them, and then go over a lot of things and suggest that you do them later. But for those that have guitars, real quickly, let's get a fingering for what works. The very easiest one of these to do on the guitar, you can bend any interval on the guitar, and I suggest you start off trying to bend through scales, just harmonize scales. But the best place to start on D and F, on the G and B string. And use your second and third finger. Don't use your first finger on them. So you ought to be at the 7th fret on the D and the 6th fret with the F. Yeah, now put the trick to all of this is where your first finger is. Put your first finger on the B string, not on the G string. Put it right behind your second finger, which it should be on the F. And that supports the string on the B string. Sounds like everybody's doing it. I've never heard anything like this before. That's great. That's fantastic. Okay. If you're like most people, probably either you've got real light strings and you can control it, or it'll be pretty out of tune at first. So just sit down and work it out until it becomes a reflex, just like normal bending is. Yeah, with double bends, it becomes really important to get it in tune. With bending only one string, it's not so important. So Sounds like it. Anybody have terrible trouble with that? No. Okay. Yeah, that's the easy one. Thirds are in general the easiest ones to do. And you might, what I suggest is try to do these things through scales, because that takes you through most of the places where you'll run into some sort of problem, and where that'll give you everything you need when it comes to actually playing with these things. In particular, concerning bends, or concerning thirds, you'll encounter every combination of bending from a minor third to a major third, or a major third to a minor third, or a major third to major third, or a minor third to minor third. So the trick is work out a fingering and be very conscious of where your first finger, or in some cases your first and second finger, are behind those notes that you've bent, because that'll end up determining whether the thing is in tune or not. A lot of them, for example, can start out the same, let's say start out on the same notes. Imagine it's C and E. They start out on the same notes and either bend both even or both parallel, or one more than the other, depending on where your other finger or fingers are. So in this case, if you use your last two fingers on, can everybody see, by the way? If anybody either can't see or can't hear, then you should say something at any point. If you use your third and fourth finger on the C and the E on the same strings, then your tendency is going to be to bend the C farther, to bend the C a whole step, and to bend the E only a half step. Okay, that's what naturally tends to happen. The B is a harder string to bend. On the other hand, if you use both of your extra fingers to back up your pinky, which is on the B string, then you might be able to get those things both to go a major third. I mean, to go a whole step. So you maintain the interval of a major third. Yeah. It sounds like it, yeah. Okay, if they sound sour, don't be surprised. But, yeah. Everybody's great at this. Okay, so you can do that with every interval in a major scale. Likewise, you can do it with intervals other than thirds. Thirds and fourths are the only ones you ever hear on records anywhere. I don't know if people remember the peg solo. It was real famous. It had a lot of double bends. Something like... It was all those thirds. And then there's the Maria Muldaur Midnight at the Oasis solo with Amos Garrett playing guitar. And he's sort of the greatest guy at this. And he did a whole lot of those third bends, too. Something like... Everybody remember those sounds from hits of yesteryear? Yeah, it's a lot easier to double track that stuff, but of course, why do that when you can play it all at once? Okay, let's take a quick look at some of the other intervals that you don't hear as much, that you don't hear because they're more difficult. One is fourths. They're really not more difficult. Fourths are pretty reasonable to do on the guitar. And typically with perfect intervals, fourths and fifths, you don't alter the interval. You just bend both of them in parallel. In other words, if you're harmonizing a scale in fourths and fifths, there'd be places where it wouldn't be a perfect fourth. But you don't try to bend that to that. Instead, you just go. This one is a similar fingering to the third one. You're going to use, let's say we're going to start on the D and the G. Notice I'm putting everything on the third and the second string. That's to give you hope. Your first finger goes on the B string behind those other two. So finger these with second and third fingers. Yeah, and then put your first finger essentially on top of the note F, even though another finger is actually playing on that string. Does that make sense? You notice those sound really sour in general? It's hard to get those really in tune. Yeah. Those are harder. If you just work at it some, I remember I spent about half an hour the first day I tried this, and after that it was always in tune when I played, at least for thirds. Okay, probably everybody's already noticing that there are other fingers around. At least you've got your pinky there, it's not doing anything. So you could always hold another note down on the top string, not necessarily bend it. But there are you get into a lot of country sounds. You know, you can just do that with a double bend. Okay, some of this will take a little while to actually materialize. People who don't have guitars, this makes sense? Yeah? Okay. Okay, now let me really just do a quick overview of other sounds that you can get with double bends. I want to go from a unison up to, let's stop at an octave. Most of these are ones you've never heard. There's no reason why you can't do it with a unison. You get a really interesting doubled sound. Sounds sort of like a synthesizer. You know how you can make a synthesizer go out of tune with itself. Just spread a unison and bend. Usually you won't be able to pull that off for more than a half step, but there are a lot of places where a half step works great. Seconds are somewhat weird. It's more like a sound effect if you're going to bend a second or a seventh. Thirds are very useful. Fourths are very useful. Fifths are something you never hear. Partly because they're hard. The main thing is play blues phrases with those, and wherever you would bend in the blues, bend with fifths. I'll let you work out fingerings for these things. Sixths are like thirds, except they're harder, but since a sixth and a third are the same interval inverted, you can use sixths anywhere you'd use thirds. So if you're used to playing in parallel thirds, then you can do the same thing in sixths. And if you're used to bending thirds, then you can bend six. So let's take the one we did a minute ago for thirds. The first one we did, D and F, bent up a whole step. And we're just going to raise the D an octave. So now we've got F and D, D on the high string. And there's no way you're going to bend that, so instead bring the F down to the same fret on the G string. So you've got F on your G string, the 10th fret, and you've got D on your high string, on your E string, same fret. And if it's out of tune, it's because you're not using your last two fingers to bend them. Yeah, if you use those and experiment with where your other two fingers have to be to get them to be in tune. Yeah. I'm hearing it.
Where do your other fingers go?
Well, it varies from person to person. What I tend to do with that one is put my first finger on the G string and my second finger on the high E string. So your second finger would be right behind your pinky on the same string. Yeah, on the high E string, like that. Yeah. And all cramped up into the space of one fret, not spread out as if it were some sort of chord. Yeah. Yeah. Does that work? Works? Yeah. As an incentive to humility, occasionally compare the sound to what it actually should sound like. That's, of course, what it should sound like if you slide up a whole step. Then get in the habit of bending up until it really sounds like that. Notice that doesn't. I never got my sixth down. Okay, with sixth, again, you have the same options that you have with thirds. There, you can bend through a whole scale. Well, I should never try to demonstrate this. You get the idea? Okay, you work it out. I don't use six. I use octaves. And those are really useful. I found that one of the very hardest ones to get. Just finger an octave, two frets apart on two strings apart, and bend it. You've got real, I don't have very light strings. My strings start with an 11 and go to a 56 on the bottom. So they're somewhat heavy. If you've got real light strings, you should be able to bend this a whole step. I couldn't make it past about a half step. Enough of octave bending. The other thing I wanted to mention is, at the point where you get real good at these, then it's worth experimenting with bending three strings at once, especially if your strings are reasonably light. One thing you can do is just bend any three-note chord a half step. I'm just bending a little minor chord. An F-sharp minor triad. At first they won't go, but once you've gotten good at double bending, the triple bending will start to happen. And then you can get into more sophisticated things like trying to bend triads through scales where the notes don't all move in parallel because of the way the scale is laid out. For example, a C chord up here to a D minor chord. This is a killer to do, but is really effective. Does everybody follow what I'm talking about? Or better yet, does anybody not follow what I'm talking about? Okay. A lot of this stuff won't happen for a while. Get the double bends down first. Yeah, great. Somebody's been doing this a lot, it sounds like. Okay, I'm going to drop double bends and triple bends for a minute. Oh, no, I can't. There's one other that's just great. I love it. Something you only hear double and triple tracked on records, but you can do it on a guitar. It's your standard Chuck Berry rock and roll bend, only you double the lower note an octave lower. By the standard Chuck Berry bend, I mean, or the standard rock and roll bend. Let's put ourselves in the key of B, and we're bending an E and a G sharp. Yeah. But we're going to double the E an octave lower. Yeah. You'll find it really hard to bend that in tune also at first, but eventually you'll get it. Makes for a real beefy kind of sound. Good. Okay. Yeah, I think I'd like to drop that one for a moment. I'm going to put off, there are a couple of things that I want to talk about next time specifically, which are harmonics and the bass line thing. But I think I'm going to put those off entirely and talk about a lot of other things here. By the way, people should feel free to sort of direct it too. If there are techniques that you're really interested in, say something. I think we've probably done double bends all we need to do though. I'd like to take a look at another thing that people tend to be really interested in, which is various funk techniques on the guitar. I mentioned a minute ago the thumb slap thing. There are a lot of unusual ways of hitting the guitar to get percussive effect. How many people do this kind of stuff as it is? People are already doing a lot of this. Okay, is what you already do the thumb slap kind of thing, pretty much, or? I see some of that. What else do you do?
Pull up and slap that down.
Okay, that kind of thing? Oh, yeah. Like that, yeah. Yeah, okay. Good. What else do people already do? Okay. For those of you that don't already do the thumb slap thing, this is a whole different kind of technique. The idea is to bounce the thumb on the string. It's not like a strum. It's not like a classical technique where you go across the string. You actually hit the thumb. The easiest way to learn the technique is on the fingerboard, because then you're forced to bounce. And the idea is, you know, the sort of snap in your wrist you get when you shake a thermometer down? You want to have that experience when you're doing this slap thing. Otherwise, you tend to get a muted sound. What you don't want is... That's really not useful. So you want it to really bounce on the string. Yeah, make it real energetic. Yeah, the number one thing that messes people up is they don't get enough bounce out of it. So experiment with that. You can also do it on wood. Most of your guitars are made of wood. You can do it on the guitar. Just try to get the sharpest, most percussive attack you can. Another thing you can do is play congas and listen to how you sound on congas. And you find out that you really, it's exactly the same principle. You have to get the duration of contact down to virtually zero in order to get the right sounding bounce. Okay, that's a single stroke. The next thing you want to work on is a double stroke with your thumb. I'm borrowing from drum terminology to talk about this, but what you're doing essentially is making one stroke of your forearm, which results in an extra bounce from your finger. See, it looks like only one stroke's getting made. It doesn't feel like two independent strokes. Yeah. Everybody seems to sort of have the idea. Okay. Then, just start playing rhythms. You can make them up. You can listen to bass lines on records. I would suggest you do something real simple at first. You can even do quarter notes and just try to get a good feel. Or quarter notes with an occasional 8th or 16th thrown in. There's an art to making even that sound good, if you just keep that going. Then once you've done that for a while and you're comfortable with it and really it's grooving along, then throw double strokes. Just like drum rudiments. Okay. Then, finally, vary the notes. You can make up any kind of line, but start playing, you know, just play some lines like that. Typically, bass lines work better than single notes on the high strings. Okay. Anybody have any questions about any of this?
Do you tap only with your thumb, or do you ever use the other
finger? Question being, do you use some part of your fingers to try to accomplish the same bounce? I've never succeeded, although theoretically you ought to be able to use your knuckles. You can certainly use your open fingers, but that doesn't work very well mixed in with the thumb. It'd be worth working on your knuckles. It'd get real painful real fast, but it's worth developing some calluses to try it. the typical thing that bass players do that I think is worth doing on the guitar is to make a normal stroke with your fingertips on a higher string, like say on the fourth string. If you're playing a bass line on the bottom string, then alternate between that note and a note an octave higher on the fourth string. Anybody who's used to correct finger style, don't use it. Instead, lock your hand up such that all the motion here comes from your wrist. It's this kind of motion, and therefore the finger, if this is the string, the finger snaps the string outward like this, sort of out of the guitar. You won't get the same kind of funky percussive effect if you use any kind of classical stroke. It's your first... That's right. Your thumb is slapping the lower string. Oh! How? How are you trying to do it?
I was trying to do it with the thumb. Slap it with the thumb. You slap it with the
finger. Oh, no, you slap it with the thumb. Yeah, slap with the thumb, but on the outward stroke like this, yeah, your finger can snap a string. I suggest it not be the same string, though, because that's harder to pull off. Make it two strings away, like fret an octave here. Yeah, and then alternate between the two of them. Slap with the thumb, and then as you reverse that stroke, snap with your finger. Yeah, the two want to alternate though, so thumb. Yeah. It is weird. Okay, once you've got that, there's really no way you can do a double stroke with your fingers. Or if you find one, great, more power to you. There's almost no way to do it. But you, to get the effect of a double stroke, you can always do a hammer-on or a pull-off with that string. Therefore, you get two notes. So if you're doing the finger pop thing, the counterpart of the bass double stroke is a pull-off or a hammer-on. Yeah. Then mix single and double strokes with both. You can do it almost randomly as long as you keep it going, and you'll get some real effective grooves. Okay, I'm just mixing double and single strokes, staying with three notes. One note on the bottom and two notes on the top. I'm picking with all with my first finger, and I'm slapping with a thumb. Does this make enough sense that people could take it and work with it and get something out of it, do you think? I was hitting B on the low string, the B on an octave higher with your pinky, yeah, and an A a whole step lower, yeah, with your second finger, which enables you to hammer on and pull off between the A and the B. Okay. Let's see. You can mix this in with strumming, so it doesn't have to all be this... this bounce thing. You can strum with a thumb, of course. And you likewise, you can strum with an open hand. So if you've got a sort of bass line going on the bottom, then you can get some chords either with your open hand or your thumb. And it's just worth experimenting with. But with the same groove, if you got... By the way, it's useful to use your thumb on the bass note a lot. It helps in muting. If you're the kind of player who uses a thumb around the top of the neck. Then try just hitting some chords with either the open part of the hand or the thumb as you're doing it. doing is open fingers. Just like it was a pick. Yeah, down or up, either one. Or same thing with the thumb. Okay. Any questions about this stuff? Okay. At the risk of jumping on, I think I'm going to jump on here. Yeah, there's another thing that you'll never see anybody do, although it's a great technique. I don't know why not. I got it from a bass player. This was the only way he knew how to play the guitar. It was like this. Played everything like this. Does it help for me to stand up? Probably screws the video all up, though, doesn't it? Oh, great. Okay. Yeah, this is a slap with the back of the fingers as opposed to with the thumb. It's not a strum with the fingers. It's not this. You have to get your... It's actually a rather uncomfortable position. You've got to get your wrist very low, below all the strings, and virtually on the pick guard or face of the guitar. And it's still a wrist rotated motion. It's still motion from the wrist. Yeah, I see people getting it. Yeah, instead of coming away from the surface of the guitar or coming down, lower your wrist as much as possible and get it close to the guitar, and then rotate your wrist a little bit to get your to get a kind of relaxed hand just to slap on the strings. Yeah. Let me come around and do this a little bit on a couple of people's guitars, too.